Evolutionism is not science, it's not scientific. During the formation of the evolution theory, during the few decades prior to Charles Darwin's infamous book, evolutionists claimed that organisms had some kind of humors in their bodies which caused them to adapt to their environment. Boy, was that scientific. But natural selection is one of the mechanisms evolutionists propose for the morphological transition of creatures into the many varied life forms, the genus of life that we see in the world today. However, there is just no possibility that adaptation to the environment can cause these innumerable morphological changes. Adaptation to the environment does not cause morphological change. For example, a dog might grow a thicker undercoat, a longer undercoat hairs, because of cold weather. But this is not a morphological change, because the dog already had an undercoat. More of the same is not evolutionary change. For example, evolutionists claim that fish evolved into amphibian tetrapods, and that by repeated use of their fins for scouting around on seashores, or rather on pond shores, this repeated use for a specific purpose caused that feature to morphologically transition into a new feature, new bones to arise, new cartilage, new structures, digits. This is ridiculous. The finches of the Galapagos Islands, which Charles Darwin noticed, had grown longer beaks in response to the environment so that they could get at their food source. These beaks reverted to their wild type and became smaller again in successive years. Researchers have been to the islands and verified this. Even so, a longer beak is not evolutionary change. It's more of the same. For example, in the imagined proposition that fish evolved into amphibian tetrapods, it is claimed that the fins of lobe fin fishes evolved into limbs. However, repeated use of a feature doesn't cause it to change structurally into something new. It doesn't generate anything new in the creature. And that's just not evidence of evolution. Changing the shape of a fish any number of times will never turn it into an amphibian tetrapod. See, morphology is form and structure, not form or structure, form and structure, form and structural design. So changing the shape of a fish any number of times is only going to result in a very grossly deformed fish, in fact an extinct fish, but not anything new, you see. For fish to evolve into amphibian tetrapods would require millions of morphological changes. Now, I debated Dr. Mark A. McPeak, an evolutionist biologist, on this subject of evolution in a series of messages, and he made this ridiculous claim. I'll read it to you. He says, for example, I work on damselfly species that live with different predators. One group of species lives only with large dragonflies as the top predators, while another group of species live only in lakes and with fish. The species that live with dragonflies avoid dragonfly predators by swimming away from them when they attack. In contrast, the ones that live with fish avoid predation by being very inactive and trying not to be seen. These two groups differ in morphology, physiology, and behavior. Now, he's stated here, there's a difference in morphology, and he has to back that up, right? Let's see what he provides. For example, the critical features of the ones that live with dragonflies are that they swim away from attacking predators. The propensity to swim when attacked is behavior. If an individual doesn't, see, here's the claim that behavior causes morphological change. That's a lie. If an individual does not swim away from an attacking predator, then the success of the strategy will depend on how much of its thrust of its morphological features can generate in the water to propel it, how much muscle it has to generate that thrust, the biochemistry of the muscle to feed ATP to the muscles to keep them working during strenuous exertion, like swimming away from predator, etc. All of this morphology, Physiology and behavior must work in concert to produce a successful response to a dragonfly predator. Now, he has claimed that muscle mass is a morphological change. Increase in muscle mass is a morphological change. That's a lie. A new muscle would be a morphological change. Morphology is form and structure, not form alone. See, if you take a human being and put him in a weight room for 6 months and let him work out for 6 months, he will develop more muscle mass. Has he changed morphologically? Not one bit. He already had those same muscles. He just has more of those muscles. More tissue of the same does not constitute morphological change. A new muscle, new ligaments, new tendons, or new bones, that would be a morphological change. Changing the shape of a fish any number of times will not turn it into an amphibian tetrapod. You would have to have millions of morphological changes, because fish have features that are not found in amphibian tetrapods and vice versa. Amphibians have no tetrapods have digits, they have legs, they have lungs, etc. All these and virtually every feature of the fish would have to change morphologically for it to transform into amphibian tetrapods. So here he has stated a fallacy. He has stated that more muscle mass, or that the biochemistry of the muscle is morphological change. That's false. You see, this is the kind of hegemony and garbage that fills your mind in school. And this is how they indoctrinate people into evolution. They want you to believe it's true, so they'll claim anything, even if they have to claim that an increase in muscle mass constitutes morphological transition, which it does not. Adaptation to the environment does not cause morphological change, does not develop new morphological features or transform extant morphological features into ones with new biomechanical functions, does not. Had evolution been true, transitional forms would be so innumerable it would be ridiculous. There would exist billions to one over fully formed creatures, billions to one. Now imagine all of the imagined transitions that would be required to produce the plethora of genus of life in this world. You're talking about many trillions of morphological changes, but the fossil record does not support it. In fact, the vast majority of prominent evolutionist scientists themselves have stated in their own books that what we observe in the fossil record is stasis. This ridiculous ancient idea, you might say, that natural selection causes morphological change is still clung to by evolutionists even after the DNA was discovered and we understood that all life forms have a genetic information recipe inside them which determines the morphology of the creature. See, the morphology of creatures is determined by the homeobox genes which are in the DNA molecule of that organism. That is the only thing that determines the morphology of a creature during embryonic development, in an amazing orchestra of on and off, on and off, on and off, the turning on and off of genes, of homeobox genes, develops the creature morphologically in the embryonic stage. There is no other mechanism which can cause morphological change to a creature. So, clinging to this idea that natural selection somehow is a mechanism for evolutionary change is preposterous. So what evolutionists then began to do is claim that natural selection working upon random genetic mutations was how evolutionary change took place, morphology changed. But that's been discredited by 70 years of random genetic mutation experimentation, which have proven that life forms which are mutated may be deformed, but the deformities revert to wild type. The organism reverts to wild type, deformities disappear, and there is no morphological change to the organism in the end whatsoever. Every imaginable sort of genetic mutation has been applied and tested upon creatures of a tremendous variety, even to successive generations of creatures, and the result is that they always revert to wild type without fail. There has not been one single instance of a morphological change to a creature observed in a laboratory due to random genetic mutation. It has been proven by science that random genetic mutation is incapable of causing morphological change.